Well, I have to say thank you very much for the invitation. I don't sing, I don't dance. And so yesterday I was on stage. But you know, today no one can sing, no one can dance. And so I will be able to make small speech. I would like to speak about two things. You know, we're talking about interdependence, and then people are looking at what it means. Let me read you something that was published in the United States on October 11, 1998. And it was, at the time, no one remembers anymore, but at the time there was a big economic crisis in the world. And a company called Merrill Lynch ran full page ads in all the United States throughout America, really, you know, trying to drive a point home that globalization was good for the people of the United States. The ads read as follows. The world is 10 years old. It was born when the wall fell in 1989. It's no surprise that the world's youngest economy, the global economy, is still finding its bearings. The intricate checks and balances that stabilize economies are only incorporated with time. Many world markets are only recently freely governed for the first time by the emotions of the people rather than the fists of the state. From where we sit, none of this diminishes the promise offered a decade ago by the demise of the world of work. The spread of free markets and democracy around the world is permitting more people everywhere to turn their aspirations into achievements. And technology, properly harnessed and liberally distributed, has the power to erase not just geographical borders, but also human ones. It seems to us that for a 10-year-old, the world continues to hold great promise, and in the meantime, no one ever said growing up was easy. This was the end of that ad. In the early hours of September 15, 2008, after 158 years, Merrill Lynch's fate was in the hands of bankruptcy administrators. The financial firm who had run those ads in the year 1989 was basically bankrupt and disappeared and was taken by another company. Furthermore, a few hours later, a company called Lehman Brothers disappeared after its shares dropped 94% at New York State Exchange, a company that in February 2008 had a market value of $46 billion was worth on that day of its disappearance only $145 million. Talking about interdependence, this is interdependence. What you will see is the fate of many companies, many people, and the world cannot be related only to one single company. If companies like the two that I'm spoken about disappear so fast, so quickly, then you have to understand that unless you really work together, you're not going to be able to work in solving the world's problems. And so there was this big author who started his book saying, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epoch of belief, it was the epoch of incredulity. It seems almost like Charles Dickens was writing about today when he really wrote his book. Because in fact, at the beginning of this year, we are looking at a situation exactly like the one described by him in his masterpiece. Most of us were ready to despair after knowing through the initial news what was happening in the year 2001, when we heard about the impact of two planes and the impact that it had in the concept of interdependence, globalization, and the fact that we should be working together to make the world. Whenever I remember those days, whenever I remember that particular day, I remember what I was doing, and what happened. There are only 2 days in my life that have really marked me up this way. The first one was the day that the President Fox won the election in Mexico, and we knew that democracy in full fashion was really working in my country. And the second day is the day when I learned that the Twin Towers have been destroyed by a terrorist attack. As if the consequence of that horrific event were not enough, in 2009, a worldwide financial crisis hit the American economy with such force that its consequences are still being felt today. As the 2012 election day approaches, many Americans wonder what the future of the country will be, whether they will be able to find meaningful jobs again, and what the conditions of the retirement days will look like. Fear of life and fear of employment mark the environment under which discussions of legalizing millions of immigrants take place today in the United States of America. And two examples illustrate this very, very clearly. First, the speech made in New York University by Secretary Napolitano gave the following remarks, and I quote, "As we move forward over the coming months to commemorate what happened on 9/11, I'm sure again the remarkable stories of the men and women who perished in the attack here and at the Pentagon and in Pennsylvania. As we detail the progress the country has indeed made over the past years, we have to also recommit ourselves to the notion that, unfortunately, the world that we inhabit is a world where an environment where terrorists exist and where they continue to focus upon the West and particularly on the United States." This remark, if you forgive me, I'm not an American, I find terrible. Because what it says very clearly is that if you look at the world, what you will see is a terrorist attack on the United States. It was made by Secretary Napolitano, a friend of mine, who understood very clearly what should be the relationship between two people, two countries, Mexico and the United States, when she was the governor of Arizona. A person who worked hand in hand with us at the Mexican government to try to find a solution to these immigration difficulties and problems that we are facing. And here she is, as now, the Secretary of the United States government, telling people that the world is a world of separation, not a world of union. The second, more difficult article to accept by someone like myself was published by a man called Steven Camarota, who happens to be the director of the research for the Center of Immigration Studies. And this is a self-defined low immigration, pro-immigrant think tank located in Washington, D.C. In this writing that he put together, he affirms the following, and I quote, "In his May 10th speech in El Paso, President Obama outlined his vision for reforming the nation's immigration system. He argued that because the border is more secure, it is now time to legalize illegal immigrants and to increase the number of legal immigration allowed into the country in the future. The president's speech seems to assume that jobs are plentiful, but all of the available evidence indicates this is not the case, particularly for the young and less educated who are the most likely to compete with illegal immigrants. Prior research indicates that illegal immigrant workers are overwhelmingly those with relatively little education. While it would be a mistake to think that every job taken by an immigrant is a job lost by a native, it would also be a mistake to imagine that allowing illegal immigrants to stay permanently in their jobs and increasing immigration further has no impact on labor market outcomes for U.S.-born workers." End of the quote. Both statements reflect the environment in which the current debate on immigration policy is taking place in the United States. And this is not a good environment for a rational discussion of what should be an important topic for both our countries. And yet, the rational debate is what we need to do if we wish to define a legal reform that will ultimately guarantee for both the undocumented immigrants and your nation a fair, orderly, but more importantly, secure solution to the current situation. Yes, these are difficult and challenging times, the worst of times, but they are also times full of promise and new possibilities. Working together, we can make them the best of times. Times that will provide us with the opportunity to have a hand in remaking and reshaping the world. Times that will provide us with an opportunity to share in the creation of a better world. Times that might help us improve not just our national condition, but the human condition of the world. As 2012 comes to its end, it is giving us the chance to make a difference, to lighten burdens, to stay engaged, to fix what is broken, and to create what is needed. I hope my ensuing remarks will help us here present in looking for such times. When it all started between Mexico and the United States? Well, the wars of 1845 and 1848 resulted in Mexico ending roughly two-fifths of the original territory, ceding them to the United States. Families and communities that have for generations been part of my country suddenly found themselves in the United States. Were they illegal or were they undocumented? World War II precipitated severe farm labor shortages in the United States as native-born men joined or were drafted into the armed forces or streamed into cities to work in factories mobilized for the war effort. In response to pressure from foreign growers, the United States government in 1942 instituted the large-scale importation of temporary agricultural workers from Mexico, which became known as the Bracero Program, and eventually brought a total of 5 million Mexican field workers into your country. Although immigration from Mexico was not subject to numerical restrictions at this time, the legal immigration process was cumbersome and costly, specifically for poor, less educated migrants. And undocumented immigration from Mexico rose at the same time the Bracero program was in operation. Were they illegal or undocumented workers? Whatever they were, pressed by anti-immigrant forces, the U.S. federal government launched in 1954 a program called Operation Wetback, rounding up and deporting about 1 million Mexican immigrants, as well as some legal immigrants of U.S. citizens of Mexican descent. The unexpected result of such anti-immigration policies was the opposite of what they sought to achieve. Thousands of Mexican workers who had used what was called at the time the revolving door strategy of coming into your country to work in the harvesting season started to define the staying for longer period in this country. Why? Because there was an assumption that if you left this country back to your own country with your family, then you will not be able to return and work again in this nation. Very interesting to find out what happened during these years. Because we did not understand the concept of interdependence, and we really understood it as dangerous and bad for my country, what we did is created the conditions for people coming from my country, Mexico, into your country, the United States, to stay in the United States. It all started very simply. I don't want to go back to my country because I may not be able to return to yours and find a job. And I know that I won't find a job in the other country. And so I stay. But as I stay, I miss my family. And as I miss my family, I ask my family to come to your country. And so slowly but surely, what began happening as an intention of stopping illegal immigrants to come into the United States transformed itself into something that is fascinating and has been well documented. This is the beginning of what we in Mexico call the immigration of undocumented families. No one but five people ended up coming to the United States and staying in the United States. But because they had no legal documents, they had to live in the shadows of this society. And therefore, they were subject to conditions that you would not impose into any normal citizen of any part of the world. But this is really what happens when you forget how interdependent we are. And so, there are a lot of studies made now in Mexico and the United States showing very clearly that we need to go into an immigration or migration reform on both sides of the border. What happens then? Well, then happens something which is fantastic and only can happen in California. As a result of this revolving door policy, many of the factors that have aggravated the situation were canceled. And one of them is very interesting. One of them is President Reagan's immigration reform. The Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986, IRCA, as it's known, attempted to address rising levels of undocumented immigration with both carrot and stick. However, other than creating the H-2A visa category for temporary seasonal agricultural workers, IRCA did not raise the limits on legal immigration to match the growing demand for immigrant labor into the United States. Despite the good intentions, the way the law was defined set the basis for the culture of stimulation and repression, which prevails to this day in the United States immigration policy. On the one hand, IRCA allowed most undocumented immigrants living at the time in the United States to apply for legal status. But on the other hand, it created sanctions against employers who knowingly hired undocumented immigrants and increased funding for border enforcement. It sounds familiar, doesn't it? This is exactly what we're doing today. This is nothing new, and we know what's going to happen again. And yet, we forget history and we repeat our mistakes. This is exactly what's happening. Why did it all start? Because in the United States, there is this sensation that you belong to the world, but you don't really belong to the world. And because in the rest of the world, there is this sensation that we like America, but we really dislike it. As a combination of these two points, what you have is policies that make no sense in terms of finding the way to integration in the world. This is not only an American phenomenon, okay? In Mexico, we fought for about 6 years when I was the president fought to reach an enlargement of the NAFTA treaty by allowing things that would make sense for the two countries, by allowing to have a solution to the immigration problem into the United States, but at the same time, by increasing the possibility of having energy investment from the United States into Mexico. Both countries would benefit. Both countries clearly needed that as part of this integration. Both countries found a way not to do it. And so here we are, not only 12 years later, but really two generations later, trying to find a solution for something that started in the years 1942. And we won't solve the problems. I'm sure many of the kids sitting here belong to this double situation. And it's a fascinating world also to me. I am the son of immigrants in Mexico. My father was French. I find it fascinating every single time when I come to the States to find the kids of Mexican parents feeling that they are Mexicans more than Americans from time to time. And that's a big mistake. My position with La Raza at some point in my discussion, which didn't give me a lot of points with them, was very clear. I sat with them and I said, look, you really want to help Mexico, you really want to help the Mexican immigration situation, then remember, you are Americans. If you don't remember that part, it becomes very complicated. Because you have to be Americans if you really want to help the Mexicans. Mexicans are trying to help Mexicans, that's why I was here at the time. But we need the help of Americans if we really want to make difference in what happens in this country. And the same thing is true on the other side of the border. Mexicans are Mexicans, Americans are Americans. We're in a regional situation where we understand each other. We have to recognize our own nationality and they understand one point which is fundamental for all of us. Unless we work together, we will not solve the problem of our two nations and we will not solve the problem of our world. And this is the forgotten part. This is why, when I met Ben and we discussed about interdependence, it became so clear to me that we needed to push something in that fashion. Everything starts in the year 2001. We are about to reach an agreement with the American government when these Twin Towers collapsed. At the moment of that collapse, and the reason why I remember so well where I was, it's because we were in the State Department negotiating the conditions under which we will be reaching an agreement between Mexico and the United States. 24 hours later, we knew that there would be no way that we could have that agreement within the next 10 years. And here we are, within the next 10 years, basically, finding out that it didn't happen that way. This is the reason why, from my perspective, it becomes very important that we find a solution to these problems. But then, as Ben was saying a little while ago, I found, slowly, another problem happening in the United States that was very interesting. I hope maybe it will rule the world, which I don't think, but let's hope so. Because what we found out was that the fight between state, federal, and municipal governments, at both sides of the government, made things even more complicated. Oh yeah, you can find very easily a city like Los Angeles, and you can find a city as Mexico City. Cosmopolitan, with people from all over the world, living together, enjoying together, marrying together, having children together. And yet, when you try to make that into one step larger, the government of the state, one step larger, the government of the federation, you find the difficulties to reach that agreement. What seems easy at the local level is very difficult at the federal level. And it makes sense. Because though we are the same countries, we don't have the same problems as citizens of that country in terms of what we face. And so, what's new in Alabama, HB 56? Well, this House bill in the state of Alabama is really a remarkable example of how can you find these difficulties between what happens at the local level, what happens at the state level, and what happens at the federal level. There is no doubt in the mind of experts that the Alabama legislation can be considered the toughest anti-immigration law in America, and it went into effect even though later on was, in many aspects, moderated by the Supreme Court. Nevertheless, the Alabama legislation, which in many ways was born after the Arizona legislation, is an example of what you should not do, but you do. Because politically speaking, at the local level, it makes more sense to do that than do the opposite. Many of us are amazed that such a law could be enacted in these days in this country. But anti-immigrant sentiment in the United States, and particularly in the states of Alabama, Arizona, etc., is a thing which, even though is not new, it is really at the highest level that you ever see in this country. Indeed, during the latter part of the 19th century, when the high volume of unchanging national origins of the then immigrants took place, anti-immigration sentiments arose in many ways, the same fashion that we are looking at right now in Alabama, Arizona, and these places. Fearful of becoming a minority in their own country, anti-immigrants proposed, among other things, I'm talking about a long time ago, 1917, proposed a law requiring a literacy test for those wishing to immigrate into the United States. Such a law was approved in 1917. Backers of the law were unpleasantly surprised when after World War I, the volume of immigration from Eastern Europe resumed to its former level in spite of the literacy test. Anti-immigration terms were explicitly limiting the number of arrivals. The Quota Act of 1921 and the National Origins Act of 1924 laid the framework for a fundamental change in U.S. immigration policy. National quotas and the requirement that visas be obtained from an American consulate abroad before immigrating were established. Both conditions remain as of today.